Hi, I'm Jason. I'm going to show you how to perform a clean installation of the Windows 11 operating system. The first step is to open a web browser like Google Chrome and do a Google search for download Windows 11. And you'll see here the first result I get is directly from Microsoft.com, and you'll want to just click on download Windows 11. So this screen appears and you want to scroll down a little bit underneath Create Windows 11 Installation Media, click on the Download Now button. That downloads a small utility that allows you to create a USB flash drive that you can then use to boot your computer up and then install the Windows 11 from the flash drive. So we'll go ahead and click save on that. That won't take long at all because that's a tiny file. And then open and run the file that you just downloaded. Agree to the security prompt and make sure you have a flash drive that's at least 8 gigabytes or bigger inserted into the computer. It will erase the flash drive, so make sure there's nothing on it that you need. Click to accept the license agreement and wait just a little bit for it to get things ready. On this screen, it gives you a chance to make changes to the language and edition of Windows. In most cases, it should be fine, but if you want to take a look at what the options are, uncheck the box here, and you can review what's underneath the pulldowns. Then click the next button to continue. Here's where it's asking what kind of installation media you'd like to create. An ISO image is actually an image file you can burn into a CD, but in our case, we're going to create a USB flash drive, so I'll leave that option selected and click next. And here's the destination it's going to overwrite, so be real careful not to overwrite something that you need. In my case, I only have one external drive or flash drive plugged into my computer, so it shows up there as D and also tells you right here it will be deleted. Click next when you're ready, and away the process goes. It starts by downloading a full copy of Windows 11, and then in the second half it'll copy that onto the flash drive media itself. Now that it's done creating the flash drive, go ahead and click finish. And wait for setup to close, and now you can take the flash drive and insert it in whichever computer you would like to perform a clean Windows 11 install on. Next, you'll need to know how to get the computer to boot to that flash drive. So again, we'll turn to our friend Google. I'm going to do a search such as Dell Optiplex 7040 boot to USB, and let's just see what comes up in the search results. Often you can get a quick answer by scrolling down. So in these results, here it is. I do remember that is correct for Dell. Usually you tap the F12 key to get it to bring up the boot menu. So what you'll do is when the computer is powered off, power it on, and shortly after, start tapping F12, F12, F12 over and over and over again, and eventually you'll hit it at the right time, and it'll pull up a boot menu, and inside that boot menu, there should be an option for the flash drive. It might have the brand name of the flash drive, such as PNY, or SanDisk, or Lexar, or it might just say USB flash, or USB, but just look at the list, determine which one would represent the flash drive that you just created. Use the arrow keys to go up and down, and hit enter to select it. And at that point, Windows will start to boot. This is the first part of the installation. It asks you to review things like the language, the time, and the keyboard layout. And if they're to your liking, go ahead and just click next. And now click install now. On this page, it's asking you to enter your Windows 11 product key. If your computer came from a major manufacturer like Dell or HP or something similar, you probably already have a digital license that's stored on the Microsoft activation server on the cloud. So in that case, you can click on I don't have a product key. But if you do have a sticker on the side of your computer, you can actually enter that code here. It goes back as far as Windows 7, 8, 8.1, 10, and even 11. So if you do have a key, enter it in the box, try it out, and worst case is you can always go to the bottom and just click I don't have a product key and let the activation process happen after Windows 11 is up and running. Now here's where it's asking what version of Windows you'd like to install. It's real important to choose the correct one so you don't have activation errors later. In most cases, the store-bought computers in Office Depot and Best Buy are running the home version of Windows, so Windows 11 Home would be that choice. If you bought a business computer from Dell, often they sell it with the Windows 11 Pro operating system. So if that's the case, go ahead and click that and click the next button to continue. Check the box to accept the license agreement and then click next. This page is asking us which type of install we want. Since this video is about doing a clean install of Windows 11, I'm not going to choose the upgrade. I'll choose custom at the bottom and continue forward. This screen asks us where we would like to install Windows, and it shows all of the partitions that are on the existing hard drive. So if your goal is to perform a clean installation having nothing from the past, and you want to wipe out all the data on the drive and have a fresh start, then you can actually delete all of the partitions that are listed. But keep in mind that doing so will erase all data on that drive. Do not do that if you've not backed up or have any files that you care about. So for the purposes of this video, this is our clean Windows 11 install video, I'm going to go ahead and clear out the drive. So you can click on each partition and then click delete. Now it's down to just unallocated space, and if I click next, Windows will create whatever it needs and begin to move forward. Now it's installing Windows 11. This part can take a while, so feel free to walk away and just let it run for a while and come back to it later. Here's where it's about to restart. You can either wait for the 10 seconds or just click the Restart Now button. Windows 11 starts the boot and the installation will continue. On this screen, make sure you select your country and click Yes. I'm in the US, so that is the right keyboard layout, so we'll click Yes again. And we don't need a second layout, click Skip. And it begins checking for updates. Sometimes this can take a while. It's best just to let it run. Now it wants to name the device, meaning give a network name to the computer. So you can use anything short, no more than 15 characters, using what it says down here. So some people just call it like desktop-PC or whatever you'd like to. Click Next. And it reboots and Windows starts to come up again. This screen tells you a little bit about the benefits of having a Microsoft account. Microsoft these days is trying as hard as they can to get everybody to have a Microsoft account, and basically you register an email address with them, and then it keeps a profile on you, which might also include your documents, your desktop, your pictures, and then as you move from computer to computer, those items can actually flow into the other computer or a whole bunch of computers through Microsoft OneDrive if you sign up for that service. It looks like they don't give any option to skip this, so we'll go ahead and just click sign in below. And now it wants us to either add an existing Microsoft address or create one. So for this video, I am actually going to skip that. Feel free to enter yours if you're comfortable with them having that information. But I do know of a trick that will get you around it. If you enter no@thankyou.com as the email address, and then just enter a bogus password, just a bunch of letters that don't mean anything, and click sign in, it'll of course fail, and it says, oops, something went wrong, but if we click next, now the installation continues without requiring a Microsoft account. So now you've got what's just called a local account, and it's not tied into OneDrive and all those fancy cloud things. So I'm going to go ahead and just enter my name here, and click next. And I'm not going to enter a password. If you do, it'll force you to choose 3 validation questions, and it can get a little lengthy doing that. So let's just skip having a password for now. And here's where it's asking you to choose privacy settings. Feel free to review these and go through and turn off whatever you don't want. But for now, we'll click next, and next again, and accept. It checks for updates, which is a good thing. You'll get all the latest security patches and fixes. And now this is the last part of the setup. It says hi to you and continues to configure your user profile. So just sit back a little bit and this will finish shortly. And up comes the Windows desktop. It looks like the driver for my video card is not loaded, so I'll do that and get right back to you. That looks better. Speaking of device drivers, it's now a good time to check to see if your computer has all the device drivers it needs to operate properly. One thing you can do is click on the Start menu and then type in Device and click on Device Manager. Up should come a list of all the hardware installed in your computer. Usually if something is not right or a device driver is missing, one or more of these items will be indented, or you'll see a little yellow triangle and it'll tell you the device that's currently having problems. One of the most important drivers to have working is your network adapter, because without that you can't get on the network or the internet. So if you look under network adapters and you don't see anything indented and there's no yellow triangles, you're most likely in great shape. So if I open mine up here, I can see that yes, I do have an Intel gigabit network connection. It's online and good to go, so I should have internet access. Now, if you don't have a network adapter that's online and you can't get on the internet, what you'll have to do is go to another computer and download the driver from your manufacturer's website, and then come back to this computer and install the file that makes the driver activate on this computer. You also might have a little CD or flash drive that came with your motherboard that may have all the drivers you need on there. So let me show you that process and how it's done. So let's open up the Microsoft Edge internet browser, and I'll go locate a driver for a network card and show you how to find it. Let's say that you have a Dell OptiPlex 7040 and you can't get on the internet and your network adapter is not working. So in that case, I like to use google.com for my searching, and we can type in Dell drivers. And be really careful, because some of the ones that pop up at the top may not be the real manufacturer and they're bad guys that try to trick you. But when I look down the list here, I do see Dell drivers and the website is dell.com, so I feel safe clicking that link. So let's go there and do a search. So in the identify your product, if you know exactly the model number that it is, I can type OptiPlex 7040 and click search. And mine is a small form factor. And this page appears. It looks like we have to click expand. Let's get rid of this backup notification. And down below, they're asking what exactly we're looking for. So since it's the network card, I'll change the category to network, Ethernet, and wireless. That sounds good. And we have Windows 11. Sometimes you might see that your operating system's not on the list, but Windows 10 is the predecessor for 11, so that's okay. We'll choose that one. And looking at the list here, so if your computer has wireless and that's not working, then we would zero in on this Wi-Fi driver and then select it and click the download button. I do know, however, that also the Bluetooth driver is part of that same chip, so we would want to download that as well. Now, if you are plugged in with a network cable for a cabled connection, what we would select here is Intel PCIe Ethernet network driver and download and install that one onto the computer that's having the problem. So I'll go ahead and click download, and the download begins. If your computer is on the internet, there's one real important thing you should do next. Go ahead and click on the start button and then click on the settings cogwheel. And this comes up and you want to go right to the Windows updates in the bottom of the left column and click that. And go ahead and click the check for updates button. So this process has your computer reach out to the Microsoft Windows Update servers. It looks for any security patches, vulnerabilities, new versions of Windows, but also any drivers for your hardware that you might be missing might be picked up and automatically installed for you. So that can save you a lot of time. I recommend that you continue checking the Windows updates until it says no more updates are available. You may have to reboot your computer several times in between, but once it says nothing's available, you're good to go. If your computer had some of the device drivers in the device manager show up with an error or that little yellow triangle, there is a quick little trick I can share with you that I sometimes use. There's a program I've used in the past that attempts to locate and download all the drivers that are missing from your computer and automatically install them. These can also save you a lot of time sometimes, so it might be worth a try if you're stuck in this situation. Go ahead and open an internet browser like Microsoft Edge, and the website you want to go to in the top address bar is iobit.com, and this webpage should appear something similar to this here. Point to driver updater and then click on driver booster free. Now click on the free download button. And on mine, the download begins. Sometimes you have to jump through a few hoops, but it looked like this was pretty easy for me this time. So once the program is downloaded, you can right click and open, and I'll give you a walkthrough of the installation. Agree to the security prompt. Now the installation process begins. I like to click custom install to minimize any junk the program might be installing that is not necessary for what we're doing. So we'll click custom And here we'll say no thanks to that. Click next, and away it goes. And it looks like the installation finished. For this one, I'll click on no thanks, uncheck the learn more online button, and click scan now. Driver Booster now will perform a full scan of your hardware. It will compare it to a database on the internet of all the drivers that are available that it's aware of, and then it'll present you a list of everything it can bring up to date. So in my computer's case, it only found two drivers for the monitors that I have attached to the computer. So go ahead and click on the update now button and click OK, and away it goes. It creates a system restore point and begins to download and install the files. Once Driver Booster is finished installing everything, you can click the X and then reboot if you're prompted. I personally don't like to leave Driver Booster installed on the computer. There's nothing wrong with it, but it might start prompting to buy the program or bug you in other ways. To uninstall Driver Booster, click on the Start menu button at the bottom of your screen, click on the Settings cogwheel, and then click on Apps in the left column. Next, click on Installed Apps at the top, and a list of all your computer's programs should appear. I see Driver Booster's in the list. Click on the three little dots to the right side of that, and then click Uninstall, and then click the Uninstall button. You can go ahead and close the apps list, agree to the security prompt, and the uninstallation should begin. Here you want to place a check mark under all four of these options to remove everything, and then click Yes. And that's it. Driver Booster is no longer installed on the computer, and the icon disappeared on the left-hand side. At this point, we have a nice, fresh, cleanly installed Windows 11 computer with all of the Windows updates and drivers installed. Some people might say that my choice to use the Driver Booster program no longer left it in a clean installation state, but if you're a novice at installing Windows and don't have hours to spend tracking down the right drivers and everything, I've found that that program does a pretty darn good job, and I always uninstall it when I'm all done using it. That way it won't bug me in the future. If you found this video helpful, please give it a like and subscribe to my channel, and I promise I'll make many more tech videos in the near future. Thanks so much and have an awesome day.